I'll tell you briefly about computational creativity, if and how computers could be creative, what that might mean, and some examples. The idea of creative machines is very, very old. We know from 1,000 years ago already of an algorithm for turning a poem into music, not really playing it out. But here's an example from the 50s, early 50s. Alan Turing, the father of computer science, he and his team, they already had the idea of using computers to do something creative. So let me play you a short piece of music their system produced. We can discuss whether the piece was creative or not. But for me as a computer scientist, what's more interesting is if the system, if the program was creative or not. We may often think of computers as monkeys typing more or less randomly. I could have replaced the image with a parrot because, as you know, language models are often called stochastic parrots, not really knowing what they are doing, but by chance they might produce something that appears to be creative. But that's not the whole picture. We can build computer programs that can be creative. Let me give you a very simple example from a month ago. This makes sense for people from around Helsinki. I was in Viikki, at the Viikki campus of the University of Helsinki, I needed to come back here to downtown. So I used the Helsinki Region Traffic Journey Planner for finding the route. The obvious route is to take the road that directly comes from Viikki to Helsinki, and there are buses every couple of minutes. But the route suggestions I got from the journey planner were via Oulunkylä or Itäkeskus. Anybody who knows the geography of Helsinki knows that makes no sense, except that it makes a lot because there's this new tram line. But this was a creative act. It was novel to me. It was very much fit for the purpose of getting to Helsinki fast. It was made with intention, not by some random process. Of course, we can ask if the system itself knew it was creative or was trying to create something novel. It wasn't, obviously. But computers can be creative. Margaret Borden has suggested three different ways of building processes that can be creative. You can, for instance, build a system, a program, that combines existing ideas to produce new ones. That's apparently what most of human creativity is about, combining something that is familiar already, but the combination is not. But then you can also make a system systematically explore the space of concepts, ideas, or roots, and then maybe you find something that is novel and appropriate. Or in the most interesting case, you build a system that is able to transform its own space, and then it might be able to find something even more novel. We can still ask, I'm not going into there today, about whether the systems are intentional. Do they have the intention to create something? Are they in some sense aware of what they are creating? Can they assess their products? Can they adjust their own behavior, and so on? If so, they might be more creative than systems that do not. Let me give you a couple of examples the two first ones are from the past of what we've done in my research group when we started to work on computational creativity some 12 years ago. My own background is in computer science, data mining, data science, data analysis. And this example project here is from sleep analysis. I had a PhD student in a startup, and they were developing this sleep analysis device, which produces data from the tiny movements that your body makes when you are lying still, fast asleep. And with some data analysis, you can then extract information about heart rate, respiration rate, and so on. And then you can do sleep analysis, figure out the different stages of sleep during the night. And then here comes the computational creativity part. We build a system that composes a novel piece of music to reflect the sleep during the night. So it compresses 8 hours into 2 minutes of piano music. So here's an example. So in the morning when you wake up, you can listen to your sleep as music, getting an idea of how you slept. The overall idea here is to improve your well-being by making it easier, more attractive to follow your, track your own sleep, and then maybe change your sleeping habits to improve your well-being. This is from a night well slept. Let me give you a different example. So here the intent is really to make the music somehow intuitively match the kind of sleep you had. REM music would be lively, deep sleep would be slow, peaceful, calm. Let me give you one more example here. Here the person falls asleep. Okay, you get the idea. Let's move forward. Here's another example. One of the early things we did in my group was to develop a system for writing poems. And first, the system was fully autonomous, just producing a poem from a topic the user gave. But then we figured out it would be much more interesting to actually give the user some ways of interacting with that. And we were doing research in the school context in 2012, where pupils could write poetry with the help of an AI system. The idea was to help elementary school students to learn language, play with language, and help them learn about things. This image here is from new version of that tool from 2022 from the Heureka Science Center, where we built together with the Science Center a system around an old typewriter where the user can, with very minimal, very simple elementary interaction, instruct or guide the system towards something they like. So here we wanted to add interaction to give the user the opportunity to feel they are creating something of their own. In the case of the sleep musicalization, it was the user's sleep data, something very personal, intimate perhaps, to produce music, which again was a way of trying to make some sense of the creative or make use of the creativity abilities of programs for the user, not just having programs do something by themselves. As a third example, fast forward to today and Midjourney image generation program, which now gives anyone here the ability to produce beautiful images based on textual prompts. By trial and error, you can produce amazing images. And while this is maybe often undervalued as something kind of cheap, it's too easy. I think it's really great in terms of giving anyone the power of being creative with the help of AI. So, to conclude, we often use AI to make things more efficient, being more productive, and it ends up giving us stress. So my vision is that we should make use of AI for creativity, giving us joy and improving our well-being, doing things just for the fun of doing it, without thinking of whether it's efficient or productive. Thank you.